Hi, welcome to One People, One World. My name is Rabbi Yaakov David Cohen. I'm here with a very special guest, all the way from down south, Yosef Yitzchok. How are you? Shalom.
Shalom, Rabbi.
Tell us about yourself. You came all the way from Florida.
Correct.
And here we are in New York.
That's right.
In the freezing cold.
In the freezing cold.
Okay.
So I'm here visiting from Miami, from Florida, and I'm loving the atmosphere here in New York, Brooklyn, and the atmosphere that Rabbi Cohen is creating. It's a great experience. So, just to tell you a little bit about myself, that when I grew up, I wasn't, per se, Jewish. I wasn't born Jewish. And my parents, they weren't Jewish also. My mother divorced, mm-hmm. and so did my stepfather. My stepfather's family, they were Christians.
Right.
Hardcore Christians. They would go to church.
Right.
They would go advance in the Tanur Halas.
Yeah, go ahead.
And they would teach a lot of non-Jews about the path of Hashem,
right.
the path of God. And one of the things that impacted them the most was that about the seven Noach Halas. Which they knew Chabad was around there, you know.
Which town are we talking about?
This is also Coral Springs. Coral Springs, Florida, Fort Lauderdale area.
Right.
In Broward, in Florida. And they were into music. They were pianists. They were pastors. My step uncle was a pastor.
And in a
congregation, congregational house of worship.
Right.
They're a Christian house of worship. And they would have their meetings every Sabbath there, have people come, play music, say whatever the case may be. And then they found out from their nephew, Yochanan, that they have Moranos,
Jewish blood.
Jewish blood. So they did it, so they were looking into it. And the rabbis told them that, listen, it's great what you guys are doing, etc., and what got you to reach there, which is the seven Noach Halas.
So first they practiced
seven Noach Halas for most of their time, meaning they dissected it,
right,
and they were very into what it brought. And one of the last things that they came up to, which the seven Noach Halas doesn't bring, is to keep the Shabbat, like keep Sabbath.
For a non-Jew
to keep Sabbath, etc. So they were like, we're missing something here to keep, you know, to keep the Sabbath day holy unto Hashem. And that was one of the main things that they started before. They actually spoke to the Beis Din.
Right.
And so that's how the journey began. And where I come in, I was a young kid. My mom, remarried to him.
This is in Florida. Right. Yeah, right.
Everything went well.
Right.
And then as I was going through middle school, high school, they were practicing it at their homes, etc. And they brought a lot of Jewishness into the home, mezuzahs and things like that. They kept Shabbos, but they weren't Jewish yet. I wasn't Jewish yet at that point. So that was more or less part of my journey.
And then eventually you wound up here in Brooklyn studying in the Yeshivah.
So eventually I was in Florida, and I came to visit Tishrei. To be by the Rebbe, be by 770, be in Crown Heights. Every Tishrei is the Jewish New Year that
right.
all the Jews flock in pilgrimage in by to be by the Lubavitcher to Rebbe, Melech HaMashiach,
right.
here in New York. And he's actually the one that gave over the message to disseminate the seven Noach Halas.
Right. He spoke about it at length in many different Fabrengens.
Correct, yeah.
And he spoke about it, how we Jews have the responsibility to illuminate the world with the light of Torah.
So I, you know, at that point, I felt like everything was a one big divine providence, and the Hashem led me through many different steps in my life, and that, you know,
but there was a certain person. You became Jewish prior to that.
I became Jewish prior to that, correct. I became Jewish prior to this. And
your parents as well?
My parents as well, correct. My whole family.
How old were you when you became Jewish?
I was 19 already. I don't remember exactly. Right. I have to look at the paper. But I was 18 or 19.
But you grew up with the Noahide laws and being Jewish, like, you know, with the Torah from a little child, from a little boy.
For a little boy, yeah, exactly. And, you know, in middle schools, I would have many Jewish friends. I didn't know they were Jewish, but now that I look back, they are Yidden.
Right.
And so this is something that I always captured. I would get invited to bar mitzvahs and bat mitzvahs all the time, and you know, you just grew up in that certain sense, and I started to connect the dots that you know, this is surrounding me. These are the things that are surrounding me the most. These are the things that are.
And obviously, you took on the name Yosef Yitzchok.
So Yosef Yitzchok
actually this week is the Yitzchok is the passing of Rabbi Yosef.
Correct.
Is the previous Lubavitcher Rebbe. Yes. Tell us a little about why you took on that name.
Okay, so
I mean, if you don't mind.
I don't mind at all.
Yeah. I mean, so, this is very interesting. Look at me.
So the name came out to be very, very funny. It's because I had no idea that the name Yosef Yitzchok was the Friedrich Rebbe's name.
The previous Lubavitcher Rebbe.
The previous Lubavitcher Rebbe's name.
Right.
So I came out of the mikvah, and I was totally caught off guard, because I thought that they would ask me for my name like a week later, when I get an aliyah to the Torah, like this. So he asked me right away after I came out, what's the name? And there were three or four rabbis, major rabbis there with big long white beards.
Right.
And they said, what's your name? All looking at me. And I'm like, and then Yosef Yitzchok just spurred out, because I just like the name. I like the way it sounded.
Right, and obviously you've heard the name before.
I must have heard the name before in Yeshiva, and I fell in love with it.
Right.
Actually, it
means, Yosef means to increase in light. Yosef,
it's correct.
And Yitzchok means laughter, joy.
Right. Back then, I didn't know the story of Joseph, and I didn't know the story of Yitzchok, but years later, where I find out that the story from them are so impactful in spreading Yiddishkeit here in America.
Well, Joseph was a pioneer in the sense he went down to Egypt,
right,
and he pioneered a new path of being in Egypt, being in the metropolis,
correct,
and having Torah and mitzvahs,
correct, yeah,
and the Friedrich Rebbe also. It was also that in the sense he came to America, which one of the first statements he made when he came to America was, America is nicht anders, which means, translating it from Yiddish,
right, it's no different.
America is not different.
Correct. Yes. So that this statement really carved, molded me who I am, even who I am now. That the personality that I have. And that,
well, you're very warm and very outgoing.
Oh, thank you.
And you have a very warm and Torah loving personality.
Oh, thank you so much. And you know, this is something that I've really worked on myself a lot, and that's something that really I pray for. You ask for things like this, and that you not only ask, but you every day, like, it's like a rock, right? You have a rock. And it spills dots of water, and it just, sooner or later, that rock is going to, like, mold.
That's the famous story of Rabbi Akiva.
Rabbi Akiva,
who was also a ger.
I think, right.
He was a ger, and he, he saw a rock, and he saw water penetrate a rock.
Right.
And he says, if a rock
can get penetrated,
then me, as 40-year-old, he was actually a robber, a bandit.
Okay.
Or outlaw, as we say today.
Interesting.
And he made a 180-degree turnabout.
Right. And he made it, right, exactly.
And his name is as a famous story with him going during the time of the Khurban. He was laughing, and he said, why are you laughing?
Right.
And he says, because if the prophecy came true, half of the prophecy, then certainly the other half of the prophecy, which is that the rebuilding of the Beit HaMikdash will certainly come true. Right.
So that's one of the things that really impacted my life, and that I saw mainly the Rebbe's idea.
You probably have a very high neshama, because it says, by the way, it doesn't say goyishin is guy. It says gershin
is guy. Gershin is guy, right?
Meaning a convert, not a Gentile or a non-Jew that converts, but it says a convert that converted. And one of the reasons is that your neshama was at Mount Sinai, and you just had to reveal it.
Right.
So you must have a very high neshama.
Right. Sometimes I have little off body experiences.
Okay. Listen. As long as we come back down, you know, it's
for sure.
Idea is to come back down into the world.
Yeah. Absolutely. And when I mean off body experiences, meaning, you know, sometimes you're able to see the bigger picture.
The divine hand.
Exactly.
Yad Hashem and everything.
Exactly. That's exactly my point. And
the hand of God in every aspect. So right. Tell us about some of you. So you grew up in Miami?
I grew up in Coral Gables, right. Miami, different parts of South Florida.
South Florida.
My parents did move a lot, different parts in Florida.
Where are they from originally?
They're from, originally they're from Ecuador.
So your grandfather went...
My grandfather's from Ecuador also. My mother's family, they're also from Ecuador, as far as I know.
Which city? Quito?
Quito. Yeah. Quito. And Quito and Quito and Guayaquil, which is like the coast part of the...
Have you ever visited Ecuador?
I'm sorry?
Have you ever gone down to Ecuador?
I've never gone down. I haven't gone back. I arrived in America in Miami in Florida when I was about three or four years old.
So tell us about your experiences here in the yeshiva or studying as a Noahide. How was that?
Okay, so here studying as a Noahide,
right?
In Morristown,
right?
I studied in Morristown to Ferris,
right?
Which is about Shiva. A yeshiva that is made for returnees.
Right, sort of like Hadar HaTorah.
Correct.
Right.
So the Beis Din asked for me to actually spend time in yeshiva in Morristown for 2 to 3 months before I actually came in the mikvah. But before the 2 or 3 months, I was actually practicing at home. My parents were going to classes for about almost 6 months to a year. I don't remember exactly before.
Right.
Yeah, it was
right.
Very blurry. And what else?
How do you find like the jump?
I found the jump very. I remember I came out of the mikvah and I jumped into the car, and I jumped. And I felt lighter on my feet. My rabbi said as soon as I came out of the mikvah, I should call him and give him a blessing, give him a bracha, which I did, for his children. Now all his children are married, Baruch Hashem. And what else? I got an aliyah to Torah, and things like this. So.
And how do you like New York compared to Miami?
So New York, I would say that New York is...
Is right. It's not so polished.
It's not so polished. I would say, listen... In my experience, in my point of view, wherever you go, you're going, you know, the Yetzirah follows you. Your Yetzirah always follows you.
It becomes in different forms.
So, you know, when a person says that the environment can change you, your environment can change you, it can change the external outsets
right.
of you. For the good or for the not, or for the worse.
Right.
But really, the inside always stays the same. You know, right.
Besides very few tzaddikim, righteous people, which remain, have tackled
correct.
The HR,
yeah.
we, I don't know about you, but I know myself, I can speak for myself, we grapple with it and we struggle with it on a daily basis.
Right.
And the idea is not to let it get the best of you and to make sure, keep it at bay.
Correct, yeah.
And to make sure that whatever was yesterday, and today is a new day.
Correct.
Just like we, some people go to the mikveh every day, so it's like a reboot, like you reboot the computer and you restart and you clean off all the old files, and you start again.
Mm-hmm.
And every day you keep doing that, eventually you'll stop, the person will stop. So you're saying about New York, about Yetzer Hara. It's not a confession.
I would say
the differences, the nuances.
The nuance is simple, that you're living the fast pace here, the fast life. And you're living in a city. And in Florida, it's more suburban. It's more calm. It's more relaxed. More laid back. Which is one of the things I miss personally. Because that's just my nature. I was grown into that.
And you can take a nap when the light turns red. You can jump into the back seat and take a nap, and wake up five minutes later.
You can probably take a nap.
I was a shliach in Miami, and that's uh-huh. I remember the lights. If the lights, once you hit a light, you have to wait for like 10 minutes.
Oh, yeah. It's very fast paced. The cold, that's one thing that I miss in Florida, is the warm weather. Oh, my gosh. You know, to come outside with actual, short sleeve collar shirt, it's nice, and with the baseball cap or something, not wear long dongs and things like this, and having to take off 10 layers of clothes every night here and there, 11. Actually, I counted today when I went to the mikvah in the morning. I take off 13 pairs of clothing, wow, including socks and everything.
Well, the limit is 18. According to Shabbos, you're allowed 18 garments,
yeah,
and then after that, it's carrying.
Wow. Okay. So
you can't put on five shirts and right. five pairs of pants and
right.
and half a dozen socks or whatever.
Right. It's too much. And I counted the double socks also. Okay. I counted every piece of clothing. I counted.
And double socks. Wow. Okay.
Everything. And.
But other than that, Yosef Yitzchok, so you're enjoying the cold, which obviously you learned to live with. I think. But you're enjoying the learning, the warmth of the Torah.
Okay, so here in Hadar HaTorah is a special type of learning that really caught my eye, and
the warmth of Torah.
The warmth of Torah. Remember, I've been to many different yeshiva. I've been to Morristown, New Jersey. Right. I've been to Tzfas in
Holy Land.
Tamim Chaderech in the Holy Land of Israel. Also, I've been in Torah or Miami for about 6 months to a year, so I see the different aspects in Torah that Yeshiva's bringing in. But here what makes Hadar Torah beautiful, that it's actually more revealed the Hadar, the beautiful part of the Torah, which is what's the beautiful, the Panimis of Torah. Really, they really focus on here, on bringing the idea of Mashiach, a conscious and awareness in it. In our daily lives, like you cannot go one day without thinking to yourself, it really puts pressure on you, but in a good, healthy way of pressure. You understand? It's more, and what makes this yeshiva that really caught my eye is that you have, for example, a chassid like Rabbi Goldberg, chassidim like Rabbi Wolfsburg, that you can really admire at the way of being. They're funny, sarcastic. They're intelligent. They live. You can see that they live a Mashiach, and this is something that really caught my eye the most. Because they won't cut you short. They won't allow you to see one aspect and hide another aspect. They really show you every type of thing and say, look, if you know the simple meaning of everything, if you know the simple meaning of life, then you will go very far. And you focus on this one point, and you let it resonate into all your facets, and then you're able to see blessings. And that's the story how I came here to Hadar Torah. Rabbi Goldberg grabbed me by the shoulder, Simchas Torah day, and he said, come to Hadar Torah for 6 months, and I guarantee you within those 6 months, you will get married, you'll find a job, and you will be happy, and I was in Florida. I was working as a mashgiach at my own place, You know, and so I left all that to come here just to keep my word, because I kept my word. I told Robert Goldberg yes in the middle of the Hakafa, the third Hakafa. It's a start of the day. And I kept my word, and I'm here, and I'm seeing wonderful, abundant amount of blessings, like beyond belief.
How long has it been?
It's been about almost 2.5 months.
Okay, so let's hope that we see the other parts of the bracha come true.
Amen.
How old are you now?
I'm 28 in about a month from now.
Okay, so Mitzvah Hashem, you know, it'll be a good time. Mm-hmm. And just like we're coming up to also the new year for trees.
Correct.
And Tu B'Shvat.
Tu B'Shvat,
right. B'Shvat represents the idea that each and every individual is a tree. Mm-hmm. Meaning it has to bear fruit.
A fruit-bearing tree.
Bear fruit.
Exactly.
And now from then on. And not only that, bear fruit and in turn the trees continues to bear fruit, and we're just a chain.
Right, right.
And we're one link in that chain going back to Avraham Avinu.
Right.
Which was the first Jew. And so this is really the idea of we're connecting to Avraham Avinu. We're bearing fruit, Mitzvah Hashem, please God, and you'll see ultimately Mashiach, which is ultimate. Which is
right.
This is why God put us in this world, to bring about Mashiach, to add to the world. You don't invest. Hashem invested. He invested wisely.
Correct.
And He invested in us, not only Jewish people. Everyone plays a role. Non-Jews also play a role in bringing Mashiach.
And not only that, but
by non-Jews keeping the seven universal laws,
right?
They create a
great support system.
They create a dwelling a dwelling place.
For example, my father's not Jewish.
Right.
My real father, my biological father, is not Jewish. People ask, "Oh, how's your relationship with him?" I say, "My relationship with my father is great, 100%. He supports me 100% of the way." Not only that, but he goes and says, "If you're happy, I'm happy."
Right,
I for sure I speak to him about the seven laws. He's familiar with these laws. So when I really say that, when non-Jews are really, you're really able to find the octave as a main point throughout all of them, you know,
find
the like
a main
thread between all of them. You're able really to...
Which is, what would you say to
me? The main thread is really God.
Bring God
into the picture of everything that we're doing.
Right.
This allows so much more space to be brought, you know, space to be friends, so much friends to be peaceful, so much friends, not only that, but it really brings out why the Rebbe really brought in the seven high laws for them.
Well,
for us also, you know, because it says in Chassidus that Jews have like a certain misnager, not misnager, but a certain goy within each one of us. That this goy wants to do like negative actions and negative things and things like this, like rob, steal.
The Yetzer Hara
at his best, right. Action. So even with throughout these, we have to realize that you have to teach art like that inner aspect also, that there is a God and there's like a limit to everything, and that brings us also to recognition of that everyone here in this world has a little dwelling for him, you know, for him or her. So that's just Bekitzer.
Yeah, so anyways, yeah. I want to thank you for your time, you know.
Absolutely.
For your inspiration. And obviously, the idea is not to make everyone Jewish, but to bring that godly light,
yes.
That godly energy, that godly positive focus in the world, to illuminate the world, which is the idea of Yosef, and also Yosef means to add.
To add. Yosef Yitzchok also.
And Yitzchok means to do it through joy.
To do it through simcha.
Through joy, through happy, through focusing on, and you know, let's hope that we get to see, that this Yitzchok, we don't have to go to the oil.
Amen.
We go to Yishalayim.
Exactly.
And
amen.
And then we see the divine light, and we finally get the payoff.
Right.
So please God, Mashiach will come this week. And then we have, today, not this week, today, now, we want Mashiach.
We want Mashiach now.
And hopefully, we don't want to wait. And we don't need to wait, because I think we've already achieved so much. Right, we achieved. Exactly. And please, God will see it. Shalom, like we said. Shalom,
Bracha. Thank you so much.
And we have to spread the light, and you have to keep learning like you do. Right. And Mitzvah Hashem will see, be a light, a beacon of light for everyone.
Amen.
For your father, for your family, for,
amen. Thank you so much.
For all people. And Mitzvah Hashem, we should only hear simchas and good news.
Amen.
Thank you.
Thank you so much.
Thank you. Shalom.
Shalom.